Hello, everyone. Welcome to Boiler Room and Native Instruments, credit to the edit, live from the ICA. We've got an amazing panel for you this evening with three guys who can talk heavily about remix, edit, dub culture. Unfortunately, Benji B couldn't make it as he was stuck in Munich, but we have Johnny Scratchley from Gentleman's Dub Club, Outlook and Dimensions on the end.
You just re-edit the sign, if that's
right. Yeah, I can try and just cut it in. We obviously have Greg Wilson here in the middle, who wrote an amazing editorial for us this week, so go to boilerroom.tv and check it out. And then we have Francois K to my right, which is an honor to have him over from New York. So, I want to start off, and I really want you guys to kind of talk amongst yourselves through this, and I'll kind of prompt and try and lead you in different directions. But our audience, I don't know how many of you guys know about edit culture and edit history, but we just played 10% Walter Gibbons 12-inch, the first commercially available 12-inch essentially. But what I want to know from you guys is where you first discovered edit, remix, or dub culture, and where you've really found a connection to it. So maybe Johnny, if you want to start.
Yeah, cool, thanks. Well, as I mentioned beforehand, so I also sing in a dub band, and that really was the start of it for me, and understanding the way that you could take a recorded sound and then put it through extra processes and get something out the other side. I mean, in a way, arguably, dub was sort of at the heart of it, with people like King Tubby and making all the outboard gear. And in fact, I think the first ever dub was a mistake by a guy called Ruddy Redwood, and he got a dub plate cut for a dance, and he accidentally, the person didn't put the vocals on the track, and so when he brought it to the dance, it was just a white label, so he didn't know it. He put the tune on, pressed play, and everyone was expecting a vocal to come in, and it didn't come in, and the place went mad, and that was kind of the first of that dubbing culture.
Well, you know, the advent of you were just saying there that it was a mistake, you know, from a dub side. It was also a mistake from a dance side. It was Tom Moulton trying to cut an acetate, and I think he ended up cutting on 10-inch, was it?
Right now.
Yeah, and then he realised that he could get much more level, he could get more space on it, and so, again, another happy accident. From my side, I was a DJ from late 75. There were no 12-inch singles at that point. So any extended versions were like album tracks. And I mean, in fact, it was the other way around, that they were reducing the tracks to put them on a 7-inch and maybe put in an instrumental or a part two on the flip side. So when the 12-inch emerged, which was in 1976, the first 12-inch I ever had was a copy of Lalo Schifer Endures, and that came through as a promo mail out from one of the record companies. I wasn't quite sure what it was. You know, it was a whole new thing. And even at the time, I don't think the marketing people would put anything out, the 3-minute tracks coming out on 12-inch. They hadn't kind of quite wrapped their head around the fact that it was to do with extending. But the one that I remember that really changed it for DJs, because a lot of DJs were resistant to the 12-inch format. They were so used to 7-inches and carrying them around. It was too heavy to carry around loads of 12s. Was T-Connection Do What You Want to Do, because it just had to be played off the 12-inch. The 7-inch didn't cut it. So even DJs that weren't really up front that were playing that as a charter were getting hassled by the audience to play the proper version. So for me, that was the advent of the 12-inch coming in.
Well, you said pretty much everything. I guess from a New York perspective, I was lucky enough to be in the room when Walter Gibbons was premiering his edit of 10%. I don't know, for us, there was no hesitation whatsoever. Everyone was so into 12 inches. It was so obvious that they sounded so much better. And we didn't have anybody hung up about 7 inches being better. It was clear that the 12-inch was the first DJ-oriented format and that it deserved to be heard. So it really was interesting, because that's exactly when I started out. When I heard Walter playing, I was actually hired to play the drums along with him by the club owner. And within a few months after that, I said, screw this shit. I'm doing the DJ thing. It's a lot easier. So that inspired me a lot, and I think that speaks a lot for those early days is that things were moving so fast. And there were these little places. I don't know if they had such similar places. Certainly in Kingston, Jamaica, they had. But in London, I don't know about the cutting houses that would make dub plates for you very cheap for like 20 quid or 15 quid. And, you know, in New York, we had that. So there was a whole little culture that revolved around these kinds of places where all the DJs would make their special edits and, get to play them out. And then, you know, little by little, some of them get so popular, they get bootlegged and pressed up and all that, you know. Yeah.
I mean, just adding to that, just to give you the UK perspective at the time, was that DJs were very much microphone-based in the UK. The whole idea of changes and blends and everything that had been going on since, you know, like the early 70s with Francis Grasso and then people like Nicky Ciano, that hadn't arrived in the UK. That really came in 78, the idea of mixing, but we just didn't have the equipment at the time. We didn't have the very speed turntables, these old belt-driven in the clubs. They didn't really set the DJs up properly back then. And it was almost like a few people tried it and everything. It was dismissed. And it came back again a few years later, much down to, the efforts of a guy called James Hamilton, who wrote for Record Mirror, who should be known by everybody. He's so important to UK dance culture. But he actually did BPM lists for the first time, and he just went on a crusade to for this mix, and he'd been over to the States seeing what's going on. And bit by bit, it came in. I think by the early 80s, more people, that's when I really kind of started. I think I was at Legend and Wigan Pier, and they had SL1200s, and we were able to kind of work properly on this. And I think really from there, it just gathered pace. So by the end of the 80s, that was when the majority of UK DJs were mixing and the microphone had been well and truly put down.
And Johnny, you were saying earlier that your parents, were they DJs or a range? What was it?
No, they're classical. My dad's, a composer.
And did he, like, how did you discover dub and reggae music personally?
Well, that was through my older sister, actually. My dad, I remember he came to a drum and bass dance I was actually emceeing at when I was like 19, and he just told me how it was a bit loud. But I think it's an interesting connection that, because I mean, if you take this idea of recreating something that was written for a specific environment, I mean, you look at arrangements in jazz, or you go back to classical arrangements, you know, taking a song that's been done and then completely switching it up. But it was a case of obviously having a quill and a manuscript and changing it that way. And so really it's the development of that idea, isn't it?
I guess both Greg and Francois, you started with tape, right? Were you working in tape edits like initially? I mean, Francois, how did going from drumming with Walter Gibbons to becoming a DJ to then getting into editing music, what was the journey there?
I think everyone is always trying to glamorize things, and because they happened in the past and you cannot go back and verify it, a lot of people tend to embellish quite a lot of details about these days. I try to be very down to earth about it. I know why I did it. It's because I wanted to get jobs. Very simple. I started figuring out how to cut the tape with scissors and scotch tape. And I didn't know what an editing block was. I had never seen anyone do it. But I knew that people had a way to do it. So I just tried it out with scissors. And I took bits of tape and I put them together. And I could see that it worked. So I decided to make versions at that mastering house that is called Sunshine Sounds. Actually became really famous because that's where all these early New York dub plates were cut. And I started bringing, edits. I mean, it helped me when I would go to an audition to try to get a job. I would beat everybody. I would just play three or four of those things, and the other people were like left in the dust. I mean, I would just like put this stuff on. It was like concentrated energy, And the other things, the other people were playing was just like so ordinary. It was like, yeah, okay, next. And I always got the job. So that's why I did it, because it was like, I mean, not just to get jobs, but I noticed that when I was playing, people reacted so strongly to those real, like, focused edits. You would discard all the boring parts. You take all the stupid vocal parts out that you didn't like. Just go for the break. Go for the good stuff. Good for the good part, and repeat it several times. And that's what people wanted. I mean, you know, it was just purely a matter of getting the thing done. That's how it came about for me, really.
And this was the era of the DJ residency, which has kind of come back into fashion, I think, now more than ever. But, I mean, you guys were playing at the same club week in, week out, putting those hours, learning that crowd. And was that really where you were getting to know the crowd and then you were making edits to please them?
Well, I think, you know, what must be said is if you go back through all the great music scenes through time, you go to the Loft or Paradise Garage or Wigan Casino or the Hacienda, you're looking at resident DJs who are working week in, week out with an audience, developing things. And maybe now with the guest thing, you don't get that chance of development that you did then. But, you know, back then in New York, I would imagine it was pretty much the same. That, you know, it was over a period of time that an audience, you'd kind of tailor what you were doing with that audience, and it was a reciprocal thing, and the vibe off the audience was informing what you were doing.
Well, I'm not really sure that we put that much thought into all of that. It was just like survival, you know, like pay the rent, get food on the table, get clothes, and move on to next week, and whatever I could do to accomplish that. These things really helped me, because I didn't have a residency at the time. As a matter of fact, I was going to do a lot of DJ battles and stuff, DJ contests. And with these things, because we were playing in real crummy clubs that didn't have good equipment, so the turntables had no pitch control. So basically, you were stuck with like fixed pitch, and it would be so difficult to mix, you know. But with my dub plates, I just came on and just like destroyed the competition. So I would win some of those DJ contests, and that's how I got jobs.
Isn't that like the DJs now with plated tapes and stuff?
I'm just saying, it was a real struggle, and I don't want to make it glamorous and make it think like we were actually intellectualizing the process. It was really raw. It was like as raw as street as you can get. Yeah.
Well,
it really was.
I'd say it's as raw as performances, isn't it, in any sort of sense? And that's the beauty of, I suppose, having that flexibility of saying that this is something I'm going to make individually for this moment in time, same as a live act, you know, creating that on the spot for that moment in time, and it's raw. Yeah, there's nothing glamorous about it.
So, you know, I kind of became known for some of these things, because the guy from Sunshine Sound, like, I would bring him my tapes, and I say, cut me one, and he goes, you know, this is pretty good. I tell you what, let's make a deal. Let me make a copy of the tape, and I sell them, and every time I sell one, I give you a few dollars. And I go like, whoa, cool story. So I was like, okay. And then next week, 2 weeks later, I go back to the place, and he gives me $200. And I go, what happened? And he, well, I sold quite a lot of them. And I was like, wow. I had no idea. It was like so completely remote from, you know, what I was thinking. I was just making them so I could get jobs and just entertain the people. And there was no further thought to it. I had never been in a studio. I didn't really know all the record labels. Nothing. It was just like a little street urchin, you know, taking a shower every 3 days.
Yeah, yeah. Within a very, very short space of time, relatively, you're head of AR, yeah. Prelude.
And, sure.
Prelude, for me, it Prelude represents a lot. With West End, I would say, is the most influential label of the early 80s, what I was playing. When I started to really take notice of remixing, I mean, obviously I knew about Tom Moulton beforehand, Walter Gibbons, John Luango, these people, but it was that early 80s period, T. Scott, yourself, Shep Pettibone, Benitez, Larry Levan, of course. And it was this experimentation, and I think this was where the dub element well and truly came into play. I did a piece like about 10 years ago, which was interesting. It was about a British record called Love Money by T.W. Funkmasters, and I'd noticed that it had turned up on lists of David Mancuso, yourself, some of the Chicago DJs as being a really pivotal record. And a lot of people at the time, I think Wax Poetics had done a piece, and they had it down as the jazz drummer, Tony Williams, and I said, no, actually, he was a British guy. And he was a reggae. He played on Radio London. He did the reggae show. And he didn't want to do a reggae track because in those days, you didn't play your own track on the radio. And so he went left field, and he took his influence from Dennis Brown track, Money in My Pocket. And he also brought in a bit of Rapper's Delight, Sugar Hill Gang, and he did this fusion. And it was a massive track on the jazz funk scene, which was like the kind of upfront scene in the UK. But then it
was massive in New York.
Yeah, and Chicago. It just like really became a very influential record, again, by mistake in many respects. So,
I mean, Francois, where did your kind of dub education begin? Was this like reggae records, or where were you? I guess the records that you edited on Prelude and West End, they had a very much a dub element to them.
He already answered the question. T.W. Funkmasters, Love Money. The remix, not the original version.
The champagne version.
The champagne version with all the drops and the breaks. To me, that was like, I had seen the Holy Grail. It was a revelation. I didn't know Lee Scratch Perry. I didn't know any of the stuff happening in Kingston or King Tubby or any of that. So when I heard that Love Money remix, it was just like the world completely changed.
I mean, what was amazing when I actually spoke to Tony Williams, and this was in 2003, he had no idea. He didn't
know
he
played in New York. I told him, yeah.
He didn't know anything about it. It was
great. But back in the day, he didn't. But after that, we spoke and all. And, you know, it really was spectacular because he was mixing with these very unusual, very radical sort of uses of reverb, and dropping certain elements, and this is stuff that we really seldom would hear being done. You know, a lot of the New York records were more known for being smooth and have a big groove, like say Instant Funk, I Got My Mind Made Up, or other things that really very powerful, you know, BT Express, you know, all these, what I like, classic or even salsa stuff or D-Train or all that. And what happened is that when I heard that, it completely, like the next day I was going around the studio and I said, we got to do drops and this and that. And we didn't have time in the studio. So what I would end up doing is I would make a cappella versions with all these echoes and then the instrumental parts, because, you know, the dub was always like, no, you got to get out. There's another client. The time for the dub was usually like 45 minutes at the end of the session. So I would make all these pieces, and then I would go back to the office, and I had like an editing room. And like all these things, like You're the One for Me, these little crazy dubs that I did of D-Train, that was all done with tape edits. Putting in the vocals with the delays on top of the track and dropping it and trying to sort of recreate that same kind of atmosphere that, you know, I had heard on that, like, Love Money kind of record. And really, I mean, of course, there were other precedents, but I'm saying for me, that was really like a bellwether moment. Like, there were no denying something clicked. And, you know, then I went on to do all these other records that had, like, that kind of vibe to it, like, even I Want to Go Bang and all that. And, you know, it was so fun, and no one else was doing it, so I guess a lot of people appreciated that. It was gave you a little more freedom rather than the very stodgy arrangements that a lot of people were doing, where it's extended, and you have the percussion, and the drop, and the strings, and the vocals, but it doesn't have that spice to it, and I don't know why, but I was crazy about that spice.
Do you have anything that you could play?
With regards to mixing, because these are not what I call edits. Those were proper mixes that I did in the studio. Sure.
Yeah.
Let me just find it. Sorry, give me a second. Because I had prepared some edits, not some remixes, but it's just...
Would you call what you were doing editing rather than remixing?
Well, it's a combination of both, because I didn't really have the luxury of the studio time being available for me as much as I wanted it to be. In other words, you know, back in those days, a day in the studio was thousands of pounds with the engineer, the equipment rental, and everything else. And, you know, the label really appreciated me doing that, but they weren't really willing to pay a lot of money for it. As a matter of fact, I was on staff with them, so it was more like, yeah, okay, well, we need something for the B-side. Just do it in 10 minutes. Please just get it done. And, you know, I was trying to figure out a way to make that work with the ideas I had, which obviously were sometimes very fancy, and they didn't really, you know, allow me to do very much. So,
you know,
the editing, go ahead, I'm sorry.
Your first remix was in the Bush Museum, wasn't it?
Yes.
How did that work? Did you have the multi-track for that and everything?
No, I mean, yeah, that was all done proper in the studio. But, see, the thing is, because I had been doing a lot of editing. See, the thing about editing that's really important, right, is you need to learn your musical parts. You need to understand how the music goes, because, you know, you actually have verses and chord changes and choruses and all these things that are not in the music anymore today. You know, like melodies, yeah. What do you call those? Yeah, arrangements. So you kind of had to learn all of that, and basically what would end up happening is I would write down all the parts when I was doing edits, or I'd made my own little charts, and it was easy enough for me to translate that to going in the studio and mapping out all the parts on the multi-tracks, so I knew exactly what I wanted, even if I didn't understand the technical part, because that was my first time in the studio. I could tell the guy, Bob Blank, the engineer, do it here, take this vocal, let's drop it here. Anyway, so here's an example of what happened after I heard the Tony Williams record. As a matter of fact, just now you heard that it drops, and the delay that comes back is a different word from the word that started, because that's all I had. Anyway, the point is, this Jamaican dub culture, even though a lot of us weren't aware in the beginning, I think it was so strong. And even in my case, maybe it took someone from the UK to get it back and to trigger me with that, but after I heard that, life was not the same. It cannot be.
And it's the same for us, because that particular record, I mean, I often cite that as being, when I talk about electro funk as being a precursor to it, that sounded differently. It had, those synth sounds and everything, it just had a different approach. Now it doesn't, because everybody copied that kind of vibe of it. But back then it really stood out. And the other track that was really important on Prelude was Electric Funk on a Journey. These were also, we played the dub versions as opposed to the main vocal versions. And Electric Funk was where we originally started using that term electro funk from our UK perspective. Because, it was a different sound, it was a new sound, and there was a big change in the air. The conventional funk and soul and disco sounds were changing. This new electronic direction of sequencers, samplers, drum machines was starting to emerge. And nowhere more so than you at Prelude and what you were doing there, and Mel Sharon at West End too.
Well, I think you got to give credit to Shep Pettibone. Like that dub that he did of Cinnamon, Thanks to You.
Absolutely.
That was like staggering. Like when that came out, it was just like, just put the needle on the record, let it play for 12 minutes. Like, it was so powerful.
Well, we were the same with, I mean, that was one of the biggest records of the year alongside Rocker's Revenge, which was a big chart hit. Cinnamon wasn't. I mean, But just before that as well, there was a track I think that must have influenced Cinnamon as well. And for us, it was an absolutely pivotal track, and that was Peach Boys, Don't Make Me Wait, Levan.
And that was a little bit later, though. I mean,
that came before Cinnamon, didn't it? Well, it certainly came into the UK before Cinnamon.
Reasonably close to each other, but I'm saying the point was that a lot of the New York scene, all these things really spread out like wildfire. Like a lot of these mixes that I would make, like the other dub that I did of D-Train, Keep On, where it just starts with the a cappella and the piano and it just builds. And, you know, it was really rare that people would make records like that because, you know, most of the big name mixers, they were really going for the jugular and trying to put something that really like was banging it out. And I went in and I did something very atmospheric. Again, it was done in 15 minutes because no budget, you know. But
what had a massive influence on me, you talk about Shep Pettibone, was the Kiss FM Master Mixes albums, especially that first one.
Right.
And the editing on that album, that really gave me the impetus to start editing myself.
Were you aware of these whole series of bootleg?
Big Apple Productions, that was another big
but
one for
the,
me.
The Hollywood medleys and all those?
Yeah, I mean, with retrospect, some of them, but Big Apple Volume 1 was a major. I think Mike Miola might have been behind that.
I don't know too much about who was doing those, but I know that for those times, that time, a lot of DJs, they would just go to the store and buy these because just drop the needle on and watch the crowd go crazy.
It's because Bits and Pieces was one of them.
Right.
The guy in Holland copied it completely and sold millions worldwide on the back of it.
So obviously, what we're trying to highlight here is that really, by doing edits, this allowed us, even if we didn't have a plan, even if I sort of jokingly referred to it as whatever I said before, we just had a sense that it was the way to go as far as concentrating the essence of what the music wanted to be like. Because remember, in those early days, producers didn't really care. Like so many times when I was hired to go in the studio, they're like, look, we're proper songwriters and arrangers, and we produce artists. We don't care about no disco. We don't want to hear about all this other stuff you guys do. Just go do it. Just leave me out of it. That's kind of a lot. I mean, not D-Train. D-Train was very interested in the Hubert Eaves, the producer, was very interested in what the clubs were doing and all that. But in general, they would write material that didn't really lend itself to being so dance floor friendly, and it was our job to do that. And the edits certainly were the easiest way to get that done because it was a way to remove, even without going in the studio, even without spending tons of money and having access to the multi-track by the label and all that, you could just do your own version. And more importantly, it allowed us to combine versions. I started immediately when I was doing edits. I would take 3, 4, 5 records or more and put little bits of all the good parts I liked and put it all together. And every time I did that, it was just like, it was magic. It really, it was a way to focus the energy more intently than the original records were ever able to. And in turn, a lot of people like Arthur Baker and Shep Pettibone, they were very astute and they understood this and they went in the studio and started producing things that had that energy, just like Planet Rock, which is really, when you look at Afrika Bambaataa and the Soul Sonic Force, they basically took Kraftwerk numbers, the beat, and the melody, you know, from the other record, Trans-Europe Express, I think. And
a track called Super Sperm, I think they took.
And they melded, mixed it together, but instead of taking the bits from the original records, they re-recorded it. And you know, this was like the most massive record to come out in New York that year. It was just like a tidal wave. That record was unstoppable.
I think what you're talking about here in terms of blending and mixing tracks together actually ties really neatly into what I wanted to talk about next, which is more about performance. And when you're editing stuff on the fly or when you're using dub effects. I mean, Johnny, what do you use in Gentleman's Dub Club? Is it purely analog or are you using effects?
Well, we used to use an old HH tape delay, but it got to the stage where I'd look over and the sound engineer's there with like a tape over his shoulder and like a pair of scissors trying to fix it all the time. So we used the RE20, the remake of the Space Echo. That's absolutely crucial in our show. To have post effects and it just adds another dimension to the music, because you've got the band on stage doing something, but then you've got an engineer at the front of house who's got an extra level of, you know, he's creating that window that everyone ultimately looks through, and that culture is incredible because it, every single time it's different, and you can feel that it with an audience, you know, you really, really can. You, as DJs, I'm sure you can appreciate that. You look at your crowd, you soak it up, and then you kind of, you're going on the journey together, and to have that freedom is just incredible, absolutely incredible.
And I guess, Greg, you're kind of famous for the reel-to-reel live, and Francois, you have a couple of effects units that you'll be using later, and you're quite known for changing and morphing tracks and dubbing them out as you go. I mean, how crucial is that to your performance? Do you always want to edit and mix stuff up and do a new performance every time?
Well, I mean, with the reel-to-reel for me, I was doing very early mixes from a UK perspective on Piccadilly Radio in Manchester. And originally, they'd come into the club in the daytime and record as live on a Revox B77, which was a portable editing unit, basically. And then they'd take it back in the studio, top and tail it, which meant put leader tape on, finishing tape, maybe if it needed an edit, if I'd stopped and started or whatever, they'd do that. But it was very quick, and that's how it worked. And then one day, I'd done the mix, but there was no one in Piccadilly to edit it, and I found myself into one of these booths. And a bit like yourself, I just played around and turned a bit of tape over, and I liked it. And so I decided I was going to buy one. I bought a home studio, bought a couple of SL1200s, and I started doing my mixes from home, and it became more complex, and, you know, there was more in there. I did the best of 82 that way. I think there were 56 tracks in there. So it just became, you know, like something that I was doing for these radio mixes. But when I'd stopped DJing, and where I use it now, it actually comes from a studio aspect, because I started collecting samples, sound effects, whatever I could find, bits from films, any bit, and I'd edit them all onto tape. And what I'd do is I'd sit in the studio when I was making a track, and I'd just chill myself back, and I'd let the tape run over the top of what was playing. And I'd say, yeah, that works there. I'll take that sound out, put in a sample, and I'll put that in more carefully. And I just started peppering it on a random basis. So I brought that into play when I came back to DJing, and people might say to me, how do you know where the sounds are? And it's like, I don't know where the sounds are. That's the whole point, is I want to put something random into what I'm doing. So I'm peppering with something different that's individual and that can only come from my direction. And that's why it retains its place in what I do, even though it's an antiquated piece of equipment. It's still relevant for me.
And Francois, how about you in terms of your effects units and your setup when you play live? Is being able to manipulate tracks on the fly something that's really important to you?
Yeah.
And where does that come from? It just, you want to be able to replicate what you were doing in the studio into a live experience?
Even back in the day, like, say, late 70s, early 80s, a lot of us were actually very intent on doing things live at the club that involved, you know, using tape delays or even early digital, delay units or phasers and flangers and all sorts of processors. It kind of felt like, you know, this was the stuff that helped make the music unique and special, because instead of hearing the same old record every night you went, we actually were like mixing, you know, breaks and going back and forth between records sometimes. Other times we'd play our edits. Other times, like say at the Paradise Garage, Larry, Levan had Michael De Benedictis play keyboards on top. I mean, we're doing a lot of that stuff back then. That's how the Peach Boys came along. They came about because of the experimentation of Larry playing these grooves, like, say, The Clash, Magnificent Seven, and getting Michael De Benedictis to do all these solos on top of all these other records. And instead of playing the whole song, he would start playing like little pieces, selected pieces that made it easy for the keyboard player to do their stuff on top. And the same way, when we were playing certain things, the effects were adding an element of like real shock. Like, you know, when you're putting a reel-to-reel echo on the full mix, on the whole sound system, it like, you know, and then change speed and go and you know, it's like, it's obviously very spectacular. And I kind of, you know, getting to know how to do this in the studio kind of became second nature to add, like, when I was playing back in those days, I would travel with at least 15 or 20 reel-to-reel tapes full of little sound effects and snippets and bits and re-edits. And I didn't even bother cutting dub plates anymore, because most of the clubs, remember back in those days, there were no traveling, so I was just playing in New York. So sometimes a little bit at the Paradise Garage, sometimes at Better Days, then sometimes at Zanzibar and other clubs like that. They all had at least one reel-to-reel machine, sometimes two, and I could play all these exclusive things from my reels. I didn't even need to have the dub plate of it. I knew how to mix with the reel-to-reel tape. It's no problem. So, you know, all that was like kind of a second nature, even back at that time. And I think as I kept going, I just felt that with the advent of all this digital stuff, and I'm talking about production methods, like, say, when you look at what happened to reggae between the years 79 and 85, and they lost, arguably, you could say reggae lost a lot of its charm that was all related to having live drummers and having a lot of, you know, real musicians like the Scatolites or the Revolutionaries or whoever else was playing on the backing tracks, all replaced by drum machines and by people programming dumb two-bar loops that kind of took all the flavor out of the music. And even at that time, even though some of the engineers and some of the people like the second generation, like King Jammy and all them, they're very capable of doing like the proper crazy dubbing that King Tubby and whoever else taught them, but it started streamlining itself. And in my case, I noticed something similar in the dance music production when house music came about. I had stopped DJing for a few years, but when I came back to DJing around 89, and I noticed that the tracks were much more linear and very even. They were more powerful. They had much more bass and punch and all that, but they were not as epic, and they didn't have
a bit of a structure thing, right? The idea of a common structure.
It's a production thing, because people are lazy and they just use electronic music production methods instead of actually playing the drums. They just have a machine repeating the same fucking thing, you know, 600 times through the song, because it's easier and they have a wife to go to or whatever else they want to do. So the point is, as
the musicians are expensive, right?
Yeah. As a DJ, and temperamental too. You know, I found that using those effects was helping me give some of that back, put some of that back in the music. That's your answer.
And I know that you have been experimenting with stems in the past couple of days, and you use Traktor and you try and layer a lot of effects. I mean, how's your experience been with being able to pull apart tracks on the fly and do it live? I know it's obviously a very brand new thing to you.
It's kind of a dream come true, to be honest. I mean, it's... like, if I'm trying to transport myself back to, like, say, 30 years ago and think that something like this would be possible, I wouldn't sleep for, like, 2 months. I would just keep trying things if I had access to technology like that. But, you know, it's a different time, and obviously technology has made everything evolve. But the point I'm making here, so with regards to these edits and effects and all that, is that again, to me, I feel it's really the spice. It's that little, you know, magic sprinkle dust that you put over the music. Instead of music just being ordinary, you can help it become something not only unique, but also special. And you, by using those, you can create more dynamic in a music that is more flatter to begin with, because you could create momentum where sections will drop and then they would build and reach crescendo and all that. And I think, at least from my perspective in DJ sessions when I'm playing, I try to communicate that with people, and that really helps me, so yeah.
And Greg, I know you're interested in releasing your label in STEMS format next year, and is that because you want people to be able to experiment with what's there and again sprinkle that kind of magic dust by using your label's tracks?
I just think it's a logical next step. I mean, before Boiler Room approached me to write this piece, I'd actually been told about the STEMS format. We've just launched a new record label, Super Weird Substance, and I was thinking, I want to be in at the shop floor on this. I want to get in on this technology. We were finding out and realizing that the system was in development and about to be launched. And just out the blue, purely by serendipity, I was asked about the, to write the piece. And this has come about on the back of it. So for me, it's absolutely logical. The next generation would want to, those kids that were playing Rock Band and stuff, which is essentially a STEMS format, a four-track STEM format, that they'll want to do that as DJs, and they should want to do that. You know, it's a fantastic opportunity to manipulate music in a new way, just like back in the 70s, you were doing it with tape and finding your way through with what you had. I mean, it was interesting before what you said about the studio, because I apply a principle where I can for my remixing, which is I like to do it all in one burst, because I kind of figured that those great early 80s remixes that I loved, it was done on downtime a lot of the time, that there was only a certain amount of time to do it. You went in and did it, and that was the mix. You couldn't get the more money to go in for another day or whatever. It's not like now you've got your computers at home, you can continue forever. And I think that's a kind of stifling thing in a way. So I like to kind of build in a little bit of spontaneity into what you're doing as well.
And Johnny, have you been experimenting with STEMS as well?
Well, yeah, I checked it out over the summer. But I think the thing for me as well is that DJing is an art form. You know, we all as music fans want it to progress. We want to see DJs work. You know, we want to see them create something that we've never seen before. And for me, it, you know, potentially represents that to an extent. I mean, when the guys at Native first told me about it, I couldn't stop thinking about just going to the dub raves and seeing, for example, Iration Steppers was the first dub guy that I went to see, and he's got a 16-track mixing desk, and all of the songs that he plays, he's got the separates for. And so he's not playing a single song that isn't basically going through that kind of process already. Plus, he's got his hardboard, you know, analog effects units and going through it. And so he can do something like, the amount of control that he's got over a bass line, you just feel like, this guy's God. It's like, you know, how the hell have you just given me an extra, you know, kick there, 16 after I already thought you dropped the bass? And that's what this kind of technology represents for me, I think. It's, you know, it's the ability for the DJ to become more of an artist, hopefully more engaging as well, you know, giving that control so we as fans of music can feel excited and, you know, and go on that journey with him. So I'm really, really hopeful. And I'm excited to see what comes after it. Like you said, it's a natural progression. I mean, the idea of maybe having a visual EQ of the whole tune and being able to control each individual part somehow and pull it apart, it really represents something very exciting, I think.
And I think also what it does, I mean, what's really interesting to me is people like Con and The Reflex, they're into going into the original multitracks, and they're so deep into that, they don't want to bring anything new into the equation. And I always remember hearing a rework that The Reflex had done of ABC by the Jackson 5, and obviously I know that record inside out from when I was a kid, and it always sounded a certain way. And all of a sudden, I'm listening to a contemporary sounding track with all the bottom end you need. It's all on the tape. It's just that now, you know, we've got more outboard gear to again manipulate that sound. And so it's been coming naturally anyway. one of the main sources for stems during recent times, as I've just mentioned, has been rock band, because they put them up, one to play guitar, one for the drummers, one for the bass and the vocal. And this is basically the format that we're looking at in the initial stage. And a lot of the kind of rework guys saw that and grabbed those and have done some great work with it already.
Okay, well, we're almost out of time, but I just want to see if the audience has any questions. Can you put your hand up if you've got one? Anyone? Okay. Maybe not. Maybe it's everyone dying to see Francois play. But if there is any kind of closing thoughts in a succinct sentence that any of you have for anyone out there who wants to re-edit, who wants to perform, who wants to make this special moments within DJ sets, what would your advice be?
Just don't be afraid. Take chances. You know, if you fall down, you can always get up. But if you don't try, you're not going to do it. You're only going to do it by trying. And you just have to not worry about falling down. You just have to worry about getting where you want to go, even if you don't exactly know where that is. So I would just, you know, with all these tools and all this technology that's available to us, I think it's very easy for people to become dominated by the software or the way the designers have created it and expect you to use it. And I think it's about thinking outside the box. It's about bending circuits. It's about hacking stuff and making it do things that it was not meant to be. You know, so many great stories are always centered on that, whether it's people that we're using a TB-303, you know, that was supposed to be an accompaniment kind of little machine next to the drum machine just to play a simple bass line, and it turned into the acid box, and so on and so forth. I think time and time again, it's clear that these kinds of things are the important parts, not conforming and not trying to just do what everybody's expecting you to do. And in the process, hopefully, you can discover yourself a little bit and certainly enjoy yourself. So, and I think the audience feels that.
Greg?
Well, I mean, I echo that. Be bold, you know, try things out. That's what these guys were doing back in the day. You know, also, I think that, you know, looking at moving forward with this whole kind of culture is that people, you know, people, now they've got the facility to do this, we're going to move into a different realm of DJing. I mean, we can still obviously go back to the individual tracks, but the opportunity to break those down is so important. And what I feel is sometimes people will say, oh, you can't touch such and such a track or such and such an artist, that's sacrilege. But for this younger generation, that's their heritage, that's their legacy, what came before. I just say take it and twist it and do with it and see what comes out the other end, because it's there for you.
Johnny?
And I think for me, it's the musicianship of it all, you know, and going off the back of having confidence in what you do, experimenting and realizing that, it's not some special skill that people, you know, it takes people years and years to learn and master. It's a case of listening and you know, doing something and experimenting and failing, but making the decisions for yourself. And I think this kind of software and it puts that power in your hands. And so, you know, embrace it, and all you can do is mess up. But as long as you're honest with yourself.
Well, thank you very much. Please give a very big round of applause for our panel, Francois Kay, Greg Wilson, and Johnny Scratchley.